Corporation. The question isn't who's bigger, it's who's better. Hello, everyone. Dick Hamburg with Merlin Olsen. Welcome to the Astrodome in Houston. The Houston Oilers in white will kick it off to the Super Bowl defending champion Los Angeles Raiders. Clee Montgomery and Doki Williams deep. Kemp's kick to Montgomery at the 11. The 25 and hit at the 28-yard line. So it's a veteran, solid Super Bowl team, the Raiders, to take the offensive scrimmage line initially. Jim Plunkett, the quarterback, Kenny King, and the Super Bowl hero Marcus Allen at running back. The veteran Cliff Branch approaching 500 catches. Malcolm Barnwell at wide receiver, and Todd Christensen, who just rejoined his teammates this week in the starting lineup. The offensive line, only one change. Davis, Hannah, Dolby, Mosbar has replaced Marvin at right guard. Henry Lawrence playing with a heavy heart. His father passed away on Friday night. He'll leave here and go on to that funeral in Florida. First play from the 28-yard line. Marcus Allen cutting back and picking up nearly 8 yards. Marcus Allen, who will ever forget that brilliant cutback reverse run in the Super Bowl that broke it wide open for the Raiders. Defensively, this young Oiler team, Jerome Foster, Brian Socia, he'll be married tomorrow, Will Socia, Jesse Baker, the best pass rusher. Four linebackers, Avon Riley, Greg Bingham, the veteran, Robert Abraham, Robert Brazil, Steve Brown, and Willie Tullis at the corners, and Bostic and Hartwig are the safeties. It's second down and three. Kenny King runs into trouble in the center of that Oiler defense. Brazil, 52, and Abraham, 56, collaborating on the tackle. It'll be third down and a yard.
Oiler philosophy on defense, they want them swarming out there. Jerry Glanville will also have them moving all over the field. A very aggressive, very, well, risk-oriented defense. They're going to be doing a lot of dangerous things out there today.
Hugh Campbell, who led the Edmonton Eskimos to 5 consecutive Grey Cup championships in the Canadian Football League, last year with the LA Express of the USFL, signed here in January to coach Houston. Third and short, Plunkett's first pass, wide open is Cliff Branch. And Branch is at midfield before Willie Tullis can drag him down. A 13-yard gain, first down Raiders.
Cliff Branch is still probably the most dangerous receivers that these Raiders have. And the reason for that is that he has not only great speed, but just an intuitive feel for getting to the open territory. They single covered him there. That's something you won't see much during the day. Branch took advantage of the opportunity.
And with it, his 475th career reception. First down at the Oiler 49, just underway in the Astrodome. Malcolm Barnwell in motion. Marcus Allen. 4 hard-earned yards into the teeth of that Oiler defense. I'd like to go back to your comment, Merlin, about Granville's philosophy defensively. When he was at Atlanta, they blitzed and blitzed. They'd bring 11 men at sometimes, and he's going to bring that philosophy here to this Houston defense.
Well, he is. Hugh Campbell says that's the kind of defense I want to play, is pressure defense. I don't want to say bend but don't break, and let's give them some yardage. Let's go after them. Let's force some mistakes. So the calls that are being made are very aggressive calls on defense. They just don't have quite enough horsepower to play the straight-up defense the Raiders would play.
Campbell trying to bring that winning tradition to Houston. Second down and 6, Plunkett over the middle. Brilliant catch in traffic. It appeared to be Branch again. Yes, there's 21. Branch with those amazing skills. A great leaper, blazing speed, and still at age 36 has such quick feet. 12 yards and a first down.
I talked to Jerry Glanville and I said, you know, I can't believe that Branch is still running those great patterns, and he's getting old as a receiver. You'll see him here stretching out on his own, catching the ball in traffic right there, taking a couple of great shots. Glanville said, you know, at Buffalo last year, I decided to single cover Branch. The next thing I knew, he was in the end zone. He said, that's the last of that.
They tried to do that in the Super Bowl as well, and Branch has 3 touchdown catches to show for it. To Branch again, but too long. Now, as we approach this end of the Astrodome, let's comment on the field conditions while we're in the comfort of the Houston Dome. The baseball arrangement, of course, is still in vogue here as the Astros battle in the National League, and that is a very soft dirt area, part of the baseball diamond, and you can see we could conceivably have a field goal try from one of those patches, one of those dugouts for the bases.
If this is not the worst field in the NFL this time of year, it's certainly in contention.
From the opening kickoff, it's second down for play. flag is down. It's against the Raiders, so they'll call it back. A 30-yard throw to Marcus Allen on that deep swing, but holding Raiders.
The Raiders are a team heavily penalized over the past years, but a team
holding
that can overcome that.
Offense number 50, second down. Veteran Dave Daldy, the center, with a hold that costs first and goal.
Number 50, of course, the center, Dave Daldy, working right there one-on-one. Just went out of your picture on the left-hand side, and you saw the nose tackle being stripped to the ground. Great catch by Marcus.
What an
amazing concentration on the ball.
Like an outfielder breaking back to the wall and just peering back over his shoulder to make the play, but it doesn't count. Buffalo, the leading penalty team last year, Denver, Detroit, and then the Raiders were fourth, but in number of penalties, the Raiders were second to Buffalo. 20 at the Houston 43. Draw play to Allen, and he's cut down in the backfield at the 47-yard line by Avon Riley, who played against Marcus Allen in college. Riley from UCLA, and of course the crosstown rival, the Southern California Trojans of Marcus Allen.
In this defensive philosophy, you very often see eight men right up on the line. The thought is, stop the run, force them to throw the ball deep. Greg Bingham there is on your right. The play is made by the penetration right there of number 53, Avon Riley. And it's Bingham who finally finishes the play on the outside with help from Riley, but that's excellent penetrating, forcing defense.
From the 48-yard line, third down and 25. Plunkett doing a great job to extricate, going long for Kenny King. Job by Plunkett to get away from the rush, and the Oiler defense gets a hand.
A well-deserved hand, although they certainly benefited from the holding call on Dave Daldy. Plunkett angry at himself. The receiver was open, and he did not get the ball to him. But that's a good start for this Houston team.
The defense moving up, 10 men on the line of scrimmage with Carl Roaches at the 11-yard line. Raymond Guy, 42.8 average last year. His career average, 42.9. If you can go into the Hall of Fame for your punting ability, Guy will be there. Aiming for the corner, and he's caught it outside the 10, still marking at the 17-yard line. So that'll disappoint Ray Guy.
Guy brought an extra shoe, or actually didn't bring it. Had to call and have them send an extra shoe in case he has to kick off one of those dirt areas. He said, "When I got out here, I realized if I had to kick there, I'd have to have a different shoe on my non-kicking foot." So they called Federal Express and said, "Get it out here in a hurry."
You hear the fans here saying, "Moon, Warren Moon, the new quarterback for the Oilers." Earl Campbell. Chris Dressel is the H-back. He'll be that tight end in motion. Jamie Williams, the other tight end. Steve Bryant and Mike Holston, the speed outside. Moon's first snap in the National Football League. Why not give it to that man, Earl Campbell, and he plows for about three. The offensive line for the Houston Oilers, and a little push and shove there. Tom Flores, coach of the Raiders, said yesterday, "I really like what Houston's doing right here. They're all young, they're big, strong, they're all number one or number two draft picks." Salem, Munchak, Bruce Matthews has moved to center. Pat Howell, and the player of the year, lineman of the year last year at Nebraska, Dean Steinkuhler.
That's a page right out of the Raider book. They have gone after the big lineman forever.
Into the eyes of Moon on second and seven.
You'll have turnovers, you'll have mistakes. So far, the Oilers have benefited from several of those, and right here, this is a touchdown. Lester Hayes has a touchdown. The ball in and out of his hands, and right into the hands of Bryant. That is a remarkable turnaround. Warren Moon breathing a sigh of relief, but they had to have to lift the spirits of these Oilers players.
28-yard play when it could have been a touchdown the other way for the Raiders. First down at the Houston 48. Big Earl Campbell to the 46-yard line. And Campbell, Tyler Rose from the University of Texas, the number one player picked back in the 78 draft. And going into this year, in six seasons, Campbell with 8,296 yards. That's ninth best all time. And last year, while the Oilers were suffering through a 2-14 year, nevertheless, here was Campbell getting his yards over 1,300, a well-kept secret. Second down, four. Jersey Super Bowl defense. There's only one change from the Super Bowl starters. Howie Long, Reggie Kinlaw, and Lyle Alzado in the front. Millen, Nelson, Martin, and the one change, Stanley Adams and Jeff Barnes are sharing the duties left by All-Pro Ted Hendricks, left outside linebacker. Hayes and Haynes, perhaps the game's very best pair of cornerbacks, and Mike Davis and Van McElroy. McElroy, a Pro Bowler at safety.
And of course, a couple of substitutions there on the pass rush. Bekel and Townsend go in to make a four-man line for them.
Moriarty has replaced Campbell behind Moon. Third down and four. Holston on the far side, Mike Haynes on the cover, and here comes the punting team on for Houston. So neither team able to strike for a score on the opening possession. Now looking at that scoreboard, Merlin, it appears to be the road team is an advantage on this first week of the new season. Kansas City winning on the road at Pittsburgh. New England has won at Buffalo. Miami has won at Washington. San Diego is going to be a winner at Minnesota. San Francisco has won at Detroit.
I think you got to be a little tougher to win on the road, but certainly that's how you get to a championship. You've got to win on the road.
And the Raiders, of course, favored to win here in Houston. Veteran John James, dying spiral. Not a very good angle for James as it goes out of bounds around the 20-yard line. Tom Flores. Established as the coach of the Raiders. You know, how long did everyone say, well, it's really Al Davis is the coach and Flores is a titular head with the team. That's not so.
No question about that, Dick. This man doesn't get the kind of credit he deserves. He is the coach of the Raiders. There's also no question about the input of Al Davis. But this man coaches the team. He makes the decisions, and he's made excellent decisions. Provides great continuity and stability for this Raider team.
Two Super Bowl championships under Flores, who was their very first quarterback 25 years ago. Marcus Allen to the 23-yard line. And with this Oiler defense not possessing the man-to-man strength and talent of the Raiders, they're going to have to gang up on defense.
Talk about a swarming defense. This man, number 54, Greg Bingham, in 10 of the last 11 years, the leading tackler here for the Houston team. And look how many players they have out there. One, two, three, four, five. I mean, that is excellent defense, and that's the kind of thing they're going to have to do this year to play good defense.
Allen, a gain of three, make it four, second and six. Allen again, close to a first down at the 29-yard line. Again, drawing a crowd. 52, Robert Brazil from Jackson State, where he was a teammate of Walter Payton, the great Bears runner. Carter Hartwig also in on the tackle. Third down, less than a yard.
Dick, these black-shirted Raiders make no secret of their offensive philosophy. They put their big people up front, they go right after you, one-on-one, and they try and run in behind that strong line with the excellent running of a Marcus Allen, a Kenny King, or a Frank Hawkins.
Hawkins and Allen are back. And it's Allen, first down at the Raider 31-yard line. Brazil down at the bottom of that pile. And the Raiders, with 5 minutes and 38 seconds remaining in the first quarter, have another four downs. Miami has defeated the Redskins 35-17. Big win at Washington. San Diego, a final. Wallops, Minnesota, 42-13. Dan Fouts, a big day. 49ers in the final seconds of field goal to win at Detroit. The Giants have won 28-27 against the Eagles. We'll give you the rest in a moment.
Big comeback by the Eagles. That was very one-sided at one time. Shot at that ball, but the Raider philosophy is very simple. They feel they've got to show the long ball early. They've got to show it to you several times in the game, whether or not it's complete. And what they're trying to do is stretch the field laterally. Branch going up here, actually almost a defensive back in that situation, knew he wasn't going to get it, just made sure that Hardwick didn't get it.
Jim Pluckett, pass situation on second and 10. He's 2 for 5 in this first quarter. Steve Brown and 54 Greg Bingham on the stop, and a flag is down. New England has defeated Buffalo 21-17. Atlanta with a 5-point lead at New Orleans in the fourth quarter. That's always a struggle. Kansas City apparently will win at Pittsburgh 37-20 late in that game. The Bears roll against Tampa Bay 34-7 at Soldier Field. Final, Green Bay by a point edges St. Louis 24-23. Dick Kenberg with Merlin Olsen. Astrodome in Houston. Welcome those of you who have seen the San Diego Chargers beat the Minnesota Vikings 42-13. Here we're late in the first quarter, less than 5 minutes remaining. Each team has had one possession, unable to score, and the Los Angeles Raiders, defending Super Bowl champions, have the ball at their own 32-yard line, third down and 9.
Did an excellent job of picking up the blitz, but Plunkett finally spotting an open man, getting it out there. Unfortunately, a little too high to catch. Tullis did a good job of being in the way of that pass, forcing it to be thrown a little high.
Plunkett unhappy with himself. Raymond Guy comes in to punt. And Carl Roaches, the only back for Houston at the 24-yard line, 10 men on the line of scrimmage. Beautiful kick by Raymond Guy. Roaches a fair catch at the 15-yard line. Racing downfield was Otis McKinney to cover for the Raiders. Hugh Campbell, 43 years of age, Washington State Cougar, graduated in 62. He was a fourth-round pick of the 49ers, elected to play in Canada, was a top receiver there, had 60 touchdown catches, coached at Whitworth, Washington, the NAIA, then the Edmonton Eskimos, where he won 81 games and lost only 22. He is a laid-back, quiet, but strong leader.
He has a quiet intensity that's really rather remarkable.
From the 15, Earl Campbell. 9 yards for the 233-pound fullback.
Campbell, a question mark going into last week's last preseason game, had not been able to play because of problems after some postseason arthroscopic surgery. Came back last week, played well, and appears to be continuing on into this ball game. Rushing 4 times for 18 yards so far in the ball game.
Look at that average in 6 years. That's the best in NFL history for average. Second and 1. And Campbell straight ahead for the first down.
Dick, there's not much mystery on who's going to carry the ball if they're going to run it. The one-back system.
No score late in the first quarter in Houston. Let's go. All right, Bob Costas. Well, the holdouts of Slusher has been a story every NFL season for quite a few. Moon going long. Incomplete to the rookie Eric Mullins, a 6th-round draft choice out of Stanford. He has tremendous speed. 4.39 in the 40. And it's an interesting story, Mullins. He was a Houston high school athlete. I'll give you the rest of that after we see him try to beat the veteran Lester Hayes.
They've decided they're going to test Lester a little bit deep with the speed of Mullins there. And you see him one-on-one. Lester allowed to reach out like that as long as he does not contact the receiver prior to the ball being touched. You see the kind of running ability he has.
Moon has to hurry the play. 10 seconds on the 30-second clock. 6 seconds. Second and 10 from the 26. 2 seconds. They just got it off, and it's Larry Moriarty, second year back from Notre Dame, with a short yard carry. Back to Mullins. Remember back, in 80 when the Pittsburgh Steelers beat the Oilers in a very tough loss for the AFC Championship. They had 70,000 fans here in the Dome to welcome the Oilers back, the Love You Blue celebration and defeat. Mullins was a high school senior at the time, and he said, I was here, I was one of the 70,000. I went to Stanford, wants to be a doctor, already accepted at Baylor Medical School. He said, what a luck, in the sixth round, I get picked by my team. And here he is, he's made this Houston Oiler club. Shotgun on third and 9. Over the middle, Moriarty, 40, 50, and a first down at the 47 of the Raiders.
Moriarty reaching back to corral that football with one hand. He's covered one-on-one by Van McElroy. And McElroy said something interesting before the game. He said, you can't give the receivers any room. I'll take it back. It's McElroy coming in to make the stop. Rod Martin is the guy that really was covering one-on-one in this situation. Moon is getting lots of traffic there. In fact, on his way to the ground, had to hear the crowd to know the pass had been completed.
One-handed juggling catch by Moriarty. First down at the 48. And Campbell for 3, maybe 4. The Oilers' first invasion of Raider territory. We have a minute and a half remaining, no score first quarter.
The point that McElroy was making in regard to Moon is that Moon has such a quick release that you have to cover those receivers very tight or he'll get them the ball. You won't have a chance to recover.
Well, the Oilers are hoping that Earl Campbell won't be the Houston offense, that Warren Moon's running ability and his strong arm will give them a more diversified and effective attack. One-yard line, Reggie Kinlaw, one of the underrated players on this Super Bowl team for the Raiders. Kinlaw from Oklahoma, the nose guard, making the tackle. Short of the first down, it'll be third down, about 2.5.
Dick, I was interested in what Tom Flores had to say about it. He watched the game last week. He watched specifically Warren Moon. And, you know, he's talking about the fire in Moon's eyes, the fact that he was in control and he wasn't bothered by the pressure, and talk about quick release. It was amazing how many things, how many judgments he'd made just by looking at the game last night.
There he is, a former Washington star. Third and 3. Oh, knocked down by 93. Greg Townsend, who, counting the Super Bowl statistics, was the leading sack man for the Raiders last year. He finished with 15, 10.5 regular season and 4.5 in the playoffs.
Well, along with Townsend, number 71, Pickell there in your picture. But let's watch Townsend. Comes in at that outside position in the pass rush. Howie Long moves inside. You see him going up using his hands. One of the reasons I think this team is physically stronger is because of the fact that players like Townsend have another year of experience under their belts.
John James, speaking of experience, this is his 13th year, now 35 years of age. Greg Pruitt, another wily veteran, back at the 10. And Pruitt with a fair catch, 12-yard line, 30-yard kick. But the Raiders, with their third possession, will start deep in their own end.
Dick, as we had a chance to visit with the Raider players yesterday, it was interesting how nervous Al Davis was. Said he was really worried. One of the reasons that he was concerned is that Marcus Allen had a shoulder injury preseason, only had 17 snaps in preseason. And Allen himself worried about his conditioning, whether he was ready. And I think the big worry for both Flores and Al Davis, would the Raiders come into this game with a kind of a down attitude? Would this you know, would this be a kind of game you would have a hard time taking seriously?
Well, no score yet. 15 seconds left in the quarter. And Marcus Allen cut down at the 16-yard line. A gain of 4. Greg Bingham made the tackle, and then Brazil was there just in case. Well, the Oiler defense on the field, and Warren Moon chatting with his coaches on the sidelines as the gun sounds, and that is the end of the first quarter. A very fast first 15 minutes here in the Astrodome, and no score.
Warren Moon will be called a rookie, is called a rookie. Certainly not a rookie in terms of play.
We welcome those of you that have seen the Kansas City Chiefs upset the Pittsburgh Steelers at Three River Stadium. Dick Enberg with Merlin Olsen. We've just completed the first quarter in the Astrodome. No score in Houston. Well, the first quarter almost dead even. The Oilers a plus yardage of 29. Each team owning the football about an equal amount. Marcus Allen has gained 23 yards for the Raiders, 27 yards rushing for Earl Campbell. No score. We open the second quarter and Plunkett to throw. Marcus Allen. Oh, a couple of beautiful moves, and he's tripped up shy of the 25-yard line. That'll be a first down for the Raiders. High up in the press box here in the Astrodome, one of the owners, executive, managing general partner of the Raiders, Al Davis. He's watched this team grow. He joined them 3 years into their life. It all started back in 1960. He became a part of the picture in 63.
Came their head coach in 63, his quarterback in that team, Tom Flores. That's interesting. United again here.
First down from the 24. Second season. No score in Houston. Let's check elsewhere. And Dan Marino, of course, with 5 touchdown throws in the Miami win at Washington. Plunkett, 2nd and 10. Draw to Allen. 30, 35, and a first down at the 38-yard line for Marcus Allen. 13 yards for number 32, Allen. So many times we've commented, he's close to O.J. Simpson, wears the same number, they have the same kind of running style.
The thing that's remarkable about Marcus Allen is the fluidity. Look how easy it is for him to shift those gears. Feels the opening, sees them, great vision. Great running backs have great vision, and then they can take advantage of what they see. Marcus does it and makes it look almost effortless.
Allen, who's taking out his frustrations in the offseason on the piano. He's back to the keyboard. Music there out to the 45-yard line, a gain of about 7 more. Said when I was a youngster in San Diego, 8-9 years old, I took piano lessons for a couple of years, and I thought I was a sissy. You know, I wanted to be an athlete. Now he says that I've got things together. I've bought myself a grand piano, and I'm going to learn how to play.
Coming off the field, one of the things he was concerned with, and I mentioned a few moments ago, his conditioning. Only had 17 snaps during the preseason, and it's rather humid inside the Astrodome. Maybe having a little fatigue problem.
That'll be close to a first down as Frank Hawkins in for Marcus Allen. That a Reno graduate. And Hawkins last year, a major contributor to this offense. 526 yards he gained rushing, 4.8 average, and 6 touchdowns. Well, there they are. Hawkins very quietly in support. That's the depth of this Raider club. And they just perhaps go down. When you go to the 49th man, you have a solid player that could be a starter somewhere else.
One of the interesting things that I picked up in a conversation with Al Davis, he said, you know, I like to keep some strength in the wings. He said, we don't always have our best players on the field. What we try to do is put our best team on the field.
Third down and inches. And in comes rookie Andy Parker, number 81, a second tight end for Tom Flores. This short yardage does not mean necessarily they're going to stay on the ground. Derek Jensen also comes in, and Marcus Allen returns to the lineup.
Raiders employing 3 tight ends in this situation, and Marcus back in there Obviously, Derek Jensen will be at the wing. They'll have a tight end on the line on either side, and the wing will be number 31, Jensen.
Hawkins and Marcus Allen behind Plunkett. Near midfield, no score. 12:22 remaining, second quarter. Hawkins. What a charge, and then Hawkins on a second effort appeared to get the first down. But the Houston Oilers, Greg Bingham and Avon Riley, met him right in the hole, and in fact, getting up slowly is Bingham.
Bingham right at the bottom of that stack. Jerry Glanville, the defensive coordinator, talks about swarming defense, gang tackling. And look how quickly Hawkins draws a crowd. Bingham getting bent over backwards and literally being hammered by all those teammates. Great second effort, as you mentioned, on that play by Hawkins. Oh, look at it. He crunched his face, but I'll tell you, he's tough enough. You have to tie him down to keep him off the field.
Bingham, now in his 12th year, played his college ball at Purdue, a native of Chicago. He owns some coin-operated car washes down here in Houston. They're going to have to put in some nickels for him and clean him up. Marcus Allen, a show of blood as well. It's a hard-hitting opener.
And this will be an emotional game, certainly perhaps more so on the Houston side. They are looking forward to working under this new coaching regime of Hugh Campbell, and he's going to have to worry about keeping them down for this game because they are all pumped up.
First down for Hawkins at the 48.
The Achilles heel of this Oiler defense right there, the amount of time that Plunkett had to throw that football. They do not have a pass rush. They don't have the opportunity of squeezing a quarterback. And of course, you're getting an opportunity to watch that ball. Isn't that pretty? Nice spiral thrown by Plunkett. Unfortunately, a little earlier, and Branch might have had a chance to get it ahead of the defender. Good defensive job of batting the ball away.
Second and 10. That's Greg Pruitt with a flag down, and Pruitt is hammered by Bingham and Brown, and the flag back around Plunkett's feet, so we suspect it is holding against the Raiders. So Bingham, look at him. Boy, he's got the bridge of his nose cut.
I wonder if he put his arm around that referee if the penalty were on Houston. I don't know. They're getting the options now from the official. Of course, that's the second time that the Raiders have been flagged for holding. Earlier, it cost them a chance to be down on the inside the five-yard line when Marcus caught a pass in the game.
73, second down.
Penalty against 73, Charlie Hanna, the left guard. He and his brother John both now occupying starting positions at left guard. Of course, Hog Hanna, John over at the New England Patriots. Marcus Allen apparently has cut up on the forehead.
Working on him like they'd work on a fighter's eye, Dick.
Ball marked back to the 38-yard line. Over the head of Cliff Branch. He was well covered by Steve Brown, the left corner from Oregon.
Plunkett doing an excellent job of avoiding blitzing linebackers and linemen charging through. A lot of pressure on that play, and Plunkett able to get away and get the ball out of there, but not able to put it on target. Steve Brown, number 24, doing a good job on coverage. Now these Oiler corners, well, we'll look at them as they line up. It will remind you of a couple of other corners, at least in the way they press these receivers, right up tight, working man-to-man.
Sacks all last year, and
And they love it when it happens. It's like a rare jewel for them to come up with one of these.
Pressure right here has to be an encouraging sign for Jerick Glanville and this whole Oiler defense. That's the kind of thing they're going to have to do more and more of.
Mike Stensrud, along with Baker, with the sack. Now Raymond Guy to punt on fourth down and about 30. He hammers a beauty. Carl Roach is at the other end, back to the 22. And only returns for a couple. 52-yard punt by Raymond Guy. Otis McKinney with the tackle. A flag. An early release by one of the interior linemen for the Raiders. We'll see whether Houston asked Guy to do it again. One would guess they would, in that that was a 52-yarder. And force Guy to kick from farther back and see if he can come up with another.
Certainly, he has the power to do that, but I think you've got to look at his average and say, we better have him try again, hoping that he may knock one off the side of his foot, or perhaps that you can get a return. Only a 2-yard return on that play, so the net was very much in favor of the Raiders on that situation.
Number 30, offense, illegally downfield, fourth down.
Stacy Turan, a rookie from Notre Dame. A lot of high scoring games in this first week of the season. The losing team scoring, well, New Orleans scored 28 in a loss to Atlanta. Pittsburgh at 27, still lost by 10 to Kansas City. But this one scoreless with 11 minutes remaining in the first half. And Guy now will punt from around his own 12-yard line. Roaches creeps up to about the 35. Kick by Guy, and we've got a wrestling match back at the 40-yard line. And nothing serious there now. No, I guess they're continuing to push and shove. Well, Guy, after a 52-yard kick, all he did after a 5-yard penalty was nail one 57. So the Oilers get it in the same place due to Guy's tremendous kicking talent. Well, that was one of those personal foul or unsportsmanlike conduct, both teams.
28 on the kicking team, 23 on a receiving team. They offset unnecessary roughness. Fair ball.
Jeff Donaldson engaged for the Oilers and Otis McKinney for the Raiders. 10 minutes and 49 seconds remaining in the first half here in the Astrodome, where the Raiders and the Oilers are scoreless. Merlin Olsen, Dick Enberg. We're back at the Astrodome in Houston. The closest that we have come to a score. Lester Hayes had a short touchdown on an interception, had the ball bobble through his fingertips, and it actually went for a completed pass for the Oilers. But Warren Moon, as he looks at Matt Millen, tough against the run, and two great cornerbacks staring at Moon in his debut in the National Football League. For five. 63 yards now for Moon.
Part of the strength of this great Raider defense in those two men right there, Lester Hayes, Mike Haynes, both with great one-on-one, man-to-man, hand-in-hand kind of coverage. But Warren Moon here beating that coverage with a fine throw, as you see him zipping the ball in. Bryant had cut back, and that's man-to-man on Hayes there that they made the completion.
Tim Smith in motion. Campbell cutting back to the 36-yard line. Now the Oilers will have second down when we return, but right now, two bouncing in the Hoosier Dome in Indianapolis. Second down and seven.
A very, very big back doing a good job of running there, but
unsportsmanlike conduct. Wow. Against the Oilers.
it the Oilers? Yes, it is. They're giving the options to the Raider captains here. Rod Martin, 53, the Raider captain, making the choice.
Illegal block, number 83, offense, second down.
Tim Smith, who caught 83 passes more than any other wide receiver in the National Football League last year, but is not a starter this year. He's playing at that H-back, and he was the culprit. Can't see it in this picture, Murray.
I believe it was back behind the play. That could well have been that he was pushing in the back on that play or going down low on a linebacker. Again, the NFL has made it mandatory that you don't chop those outside people down low on their legs.
Less than 10 minutes remaining in the half here in Houston. Still no score. Howie Long chasing Moon and almost intercepted. Two black jerseys over there. Jeff Barnes, 56, and making a dive, 23, Otis McKinney.
Howie Long, one of the quickest of the defensive linemen on this team, and you saw the quickness of Warren Moon on that play as he got to the outside. He'd like a little more room on this field, wouldn't he, Dick?
Well, he was used to that luxury of added yards. Valeris's home field the last 6 years up in Edmonton. You can see the width of the field, considerably more room there, 11-plus yards. And even in the end zone, 15 more yards. We'll talk more about that later. But you look at that square footage, yeah, only over 4,000 more square feet in which to operate in the Canadian League, 110 yards longer. Contact. That was Alzado in there first to force him up in the cup where Bill Pakel, 71, registered the sack.
We'd mentioned the size of that field.
Whoops, it's against the Raiders.
Well, that's interesting. Here's a little history for us, Dick.
We were up there during the strike 2 years ago. You see how he rolls defense, to the left by now. He'd almost be out of bounds. Throws the ball. There's still all that room. The width of the field, and everyone has commented on, well, will Moon be able to adjust to the shorter distances, the width of the field? And it was interesting yesterday. Both he and Hugh Campbell said that's not the problem. It's when you get inside the 20 that's been the most difficult.
Well, the end zone, because that field does get smaller and smaller and smaller, and that has been difficult for Warren Moon and the Oilers to adjust to.
Figured after stepping up.
I got to think that he's just maybe a little bit too tight. You know, he said, look, I'm going to just approach this like a regular game, but with all of the hoopla and all the preparation and all of the, you know, laying awake at night and thinking about this game, and you see the emotion there. He's an emotional young man on the field, very quiet off the field. Got to believe that maybe there's a little bit too much adrenaline pumping through his body right now.
Now the Raiders are going to get it. Pruitt back at the 30. James kick is short. Pruitt at the 34. To the 39-yard line. Pruitt, who set a National Football League record last year for most yards in punt returns. He's still alive and kicking and contributing to this Super Bowl team. Timeout, 9:28 left, first half. Alan Olson at the Houston Astrodome. I want just to show you the difference. I've got a fairly good-sized hand, the difference in these two hands. Well, the one thing, the point is that there's no rings on there.
The fingers are a little crooked on there, too.
Yeah, there's some bad-looking knuckles there. Yeah. But this ring for the Los Angeles Raiders, a Super Bowl ring, it takes a hand like yours to wear it. I swear, I'd have to put that on three fingers. It is big enough, that's for certain.
Well, a third time around, I guess they certainly fell, and justifiably so, they deserved a big ring.
With the ball, no score. Second quarter, Plunkett going to run at 40, and he steps out of bounds near midfield. Jim Plunkett, he was a little upset with you. You said last week something about his appearance.
Oh, well, he got after me yesterday. He said, my wife's got a bone to pick with you. He said, on the broadcast last week, he said, I wasn't one of the better-looking quarterbacks in the NFL. And she said, well, Dick, I know that, but does Merlin have to tell everybody? I was talking about his appearance as a quarterback, the fact that he's sometimes awkward. But let me tell you, Plunkett ran extremely well, looked great on that play. He has shown us some real physical dexterity in getting away from the pass rush today and choosing to run on that play. I'm impressed. Jerry, I'm sorry. I didn't mean anything about your husband.
No, I'm sure the apology is received. He was kidding.
He's going long, and Branch is open. Hit him in the shoulder pad. It appeared Branch had six. Willie Tullis was a step behind.
That's the kind that Branch will replay a few times in his sleep. And, of course, it will be replayed many times on the film because that ball should have and could have been caught. And Branch doesn't miss many that bounce into his hands that way.
Hit him right in the helmet, Merlin.
Certainly did. I think he just misjudged the ball. It could be that he's looking up into this backdrop. This is, you know, one of the things about playing indoors. It changes the way you look at a football because you got a lot of things to look up into, lights, and there's a skylight up there. It's not an easy backdrop to catch a ball out of.
Third and short. And the Oilers say they've recovered a fumble. No signal yet from the officials.
Swarming and gang tackling. That's the emphasis on this defense. And let's look at the result. Marcus Allen taking the ball. He's trying to slide to the open turf. One, two, three, four, five. Five white shirts stacking into him. And the question is to whether Marcus was able to get that yardage or not.
Greg Bingham, 54, the veteran inside linebacker, led the charge. Marcus watching, as is Bingham, the measurement, and it's short of the first down.
And Dick, who would have thought that the lowliest team in the league the past two seasons would come to this point in this ball game, shutting out the Raiders so far in a 0-0 ball game.
9 minutes and 10 seconds left in the half. And Hugh Campbell's young Oilers will get the ball. Roaches back inside the 10. Make that now Steve Brown. Brown has replaced Roaches. And Guy kicking as well as ever. There's Brown, second-year quarterback from Oregon. With good field position.
Well, how do you nullify the great weapons of the Raiders? You get some pressure on them. You try and take them out of their rhythm. But I think Guy was worried about the dirt, too. He was looking down at that field. Had an impact on his kick there.
Only 20 yards on the punt. Back in the Astrodome. Baseball alignment, the sellout, around 46,000 fans. Some of them have not used their tickets on a rainy Sunday afternoon on this Labor Day weekend. After the 20-yard punt by Guy, and that play gets off rather poorly. While they untangle that scramble, let's remind you that today's game is brought to you by Chevrolet, with the performance, the style, the innovation, the quality, and the value that make up today's Chevrolet. By Old Milwaukee and Old Milwaukee Light, it doesn't get any better than this. And by Apple Computer.
Number 74, first down.
Well, 5 yards marked off against the Oilers. First and 15 back at the 26.
Call it against the center, Bruce Matthews. Matthews must have twitched with that ball, started to move it. Of course, illegal for the center to do that. Illegal for any of those offensive men to lift up after they're down in position.
One back offense. That's Bryant in motion, Campbell behind Moon. Draw play, and Campbell runs into two black jerseys, 56 Barnes and 75 Long, and a flag is down.
Not much to applaud about if you're an Oilers fan on that play, and on top of it, you got a penalty.
Now here with the loss to Campbell, I'm sure Matt Millen and Rod Martin will take the play.
Illegal formation, offense, penalty is declined, second down.
Well, I think Campbell has to be concerned at this point that you don't want to have those mistakes, but he certainly has got to be pleased so far with the score in this ball game, and basically certainly happy with his defense. Not as happy with the offensive performance, in particular of Moon. Moon a little bit shaky here in the early going.
Second down and 21. You blue, and then the last couple of years the Houston fans have loved to boo because there have only been three wins in those 2 years. Updating the late games, the Colts leading the Jets 7-0 in the second quarter. Curtis Dickey on a 4-yard run, and it's 6-3 in a battle of field goals. Denver and Cincinnati. No, it was John Elway to Butch Johnson, 25-yard touchdown pass, but the extra point no good. Denver leading by three. Pakel was quick enough to stay with the quarterback.
Pakel coming from the inside in his defensive tackle position. You'll see him on a stunt all the way around the backside. Moon doing a Tarkington reverse roll, but it actually took Pakel the outside. Now watch Pakel coming all the way around the other two defensive linemen at the outside, and he's actually knocked out into Moon. I think his momentum would have carried him by Moon, but he was pushed by the tackle, and that carried him right out into the path of the quarterback.
So minus 14 yards on the sack, and now James is going to have to punt from about his own goal line with Pruitt standing at midfield. It's a beautiful kick. Pruitt all the way back to his 36-yard line. 40. Now he's got some blockers, and down he goes at the 42. Moriarty made the tackle for Houston, and John James roots out a 52-yarder from his own goal line.
He's not known as a boomer. He got it in the air on that one.
With 7:26 remaining in the first half, still no score under the dome. Play here against Houston. Plunkett to Todd Christensen. He's to the 45-yard line of Houston and a first down. Jesse Baker trailing the play, helped out Bingham on the tackle.
Todd Christensen, of course, just reporting back last Saturday, actually, the day before the game. They put him through double day practices, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. Of course, let him come back in. The Raiders aren't a punitive operation. They said, he's our starter, he's going to play. Let's get him back in there. He's probably a little sore. He's probably not quite ready to play, but he is their tight end, and they want him in the ball game.
First down at the Houston 45 for Plunkett. Tipped in the air and almost caught by Christensen. Defensive effort by 36 Carter Hartwig, almost like a basketball player deflecting a pass as it was about to flop right into the arms of Christensen.
Fans watching on the television or perhaps here might say, well, that obviously was an interference call. Hartwig had bumped into Christensen before the ball arrived. But when the ball is batted, there are no interference calls downfield. And that was a good opportunity to see that rule in action as Todd Christensen indeed had a chance to catch that ball, but Hartwig did a good job of batting it away.
Not a good first half for Plunkett, only 4 of 13. Second down and 10. Wide open is Branch, but he slips at the 30-yard line. He had found an opening. Robert Brazil saying, can I help you up, sir?
One of the interesting things about the Raiders, they don't worry nearly as much about those averages as a lot of teams do. Their concern is, for one thing, getting points, getting the ball into the end zone. Something else that you saw on that play in regards to their passing game, the Raiders do not try and throw the ball just as the backs cut. They feel there are a lot of bad things that can happen. Back can fall down, the whole thing. They wait until the back is out of the cut. In that case, it didn't help. He fell down anyway.
He hit at the 39-yard line, short of the first down. But again, Plunkett showing his strength as he has throughout his collegiate and professional career. That first man doesn't always get him down. Carter Hartwig and Brian Socia finally made the tackle of Plunkett.
We better get Jimmy to practice his safe slide. He's a little late going to the ground on this one. I'm sure he knew where the first down was, trying to get it. Probably should have go down a little quicker as he gets pinched in there between the two defenders and took a couple of good shots.
Fourth down and three, and Ray Guy will try to aim one toward the corner. Excellent kick around the 5-yard line from this angle. Yeah, there it is, right at the 5. 32-yard punt, no return. The Oilers will begin deep in their own end. No score, 5:44 left in the half. Number one, Warren Moon and his young Houston offense huddling in the end zone. They spot the ball at the 6-yard line on Guy's well-angled punt. Dean Steinkuhler, number 70, the right tackle, the number one pick by the Oilers and the second pick in the draft. And he's working against Howie Long, the all-pro end of the Raiders. And there's the fumble, and Earl Campbell falls on the loose ball. We were about to say there has not been a turnover in this game, and very nearly Campbell, a disastrous fumble deep in his own end.
Raider coaching staff showing a lot of respect for the way these Raiders have played. They're playing a tough, hard-nosed defense against them, but interesting, the Oilers just haven't been able to get on track. They just haven't been able to get anything going offensively. Their defense doing an excellent job, but offensively, not getting anything moving.
Credit Campbell with a yard on the fumble at 2nd and 9.
Thing that Warren Moon fans from Canada, from Washington, will remember about Moon. He is a very active quarterback. He throws extremely well on the run. And this is the toughest throw to make. Running against his strength. Running to the left and throwing with your right arm. Look how he has to get back and get it across. And yet, that's an absolutely perfect pass and an excellent catch.
Bryant, a third-year man from Purdue, has his third catch of this game. First down, and Lyle Alzado is in the backfield embracing Moon, and we'll see whether he was drawn offside. He says, yep, somebody moved. I've seen too much of that in my years, I know.
Harvey Salem, number 73, is the offensive tackle across from Alzado, and I think if I saw Alzado lining up on the other side and growling and panicking, I might be a little eager to get back and try to block him on my own. Let's take a quick look at it. Chance, so this is the other side. This is Steinkuhler and Howie Long. But that's a pretty good stop there. There's Alzado coming all the way across.
False start. Offensive left tackle. First down.
So the left tackle, Harvey Salem, on Alzado, moved prematurely. This is the other side of the line.
Steinkuhler, there was the move. They actually called it, I think, maybe on Steinkuhler on the other side. And was that move perhaps that initiated it? At least they may have seen that to get him started anyway.
Here's the young man from Nebraska, 6'3 and 273 pounds. First down, 15. That's Tim Smith in motion. Moon to Campbell. And Campbell coming back this way to the 20-yard line. Well, they don't throw much to Earl Campbell. Not the greatest receiver among running backs in the National Football League. In fact, it's almost an inside joke here. He'll take punts just to see how many he can catch.
Where Kenny Stabler came here as a quarterback, Kenny said, I'm going to teach Earl how to catch the ball. He said, I know he's going to be a great receiver. I'm going to teach him how to catch the ball. After a while, he said, nope. Mentally on that last play.
Unsportsmanlike conduct against the Raiders. Van McElroy, apparently, and that was after the play was over.
In the practice yesterday, Earl, I guess, when he was hurt, was catching punts in the training camp. And they had
unnecessary roughness, number 93, between the downs.
That's dead ball
it's
foul.
It's first down.
Not McElroy, but 93, Greg Townsend.
Dead ball foul. Well, to finish the story, they would take bets. Robert Brazil was the bookie, and they would bet a dollar that he wouldn't catch it, or a dollar he would. Couldn't get anybody to bet he would catch him after a while.
Well, after watching him yesterday, you could see why.
There's Townsend on the sideline.
Costly mistake for the Raiders that allows Moon and the Oilers a first down out at the 35-yard line. Still no score. 4:22 left in the first half. Just a couple of yards for Campbell. And we have another skirmish down at the 45-yard line between Mike Holston, 84, and
Lester
one of the
Hayes.
Raider defensive backs, Hayes.
Lester Hayes. Looks like Holston is trying to get up off the ground. And Lester Hayes, I believe, is going to be ticketed for a foul here. Looks like Holston was trying to get off the ground, and Lester wouldn't let him up. One of the reasons that Holston started this game is because he is a much more physical player than Tim Smith. And that might be the result of the little physical activity going on between those two.
Well, back-to-back 15-yard penalties. The personal fouls.
Unnecessary roughness, number 37. First down.
Well, the Raiders in their black jerseys and silver helmets, they've had the reputation through the years of being very physical, and sometimes it's costly. First down at the Raider 47-yard line. 60 yards and penalties for Los Angeles in this first half. Now, Moon has his team in L.A. territory at the 47.
Should have been a reception. Moon zips that ball. Look at that. That's a beautiful spiral. And absolutely thrown in a place that it should have been caught. And Mullins, I'm sure, regretting that he did not keep his hands on that football.
It's an interesting combination. Moon to Mullins. Moon Mullins.
Moon Mullins.
They may have fun with that before the year's
Mullins
over.
Mullins didn't even start at Stanford. They talk about that. They say, this man is so talented as a receiver, we can't believe he wasn't a starter at Stanford.
10 at the Raider 47. Quickie to the tight end, and it's Chris Dressel out of bounds with his first catch, a 7-yard play. It'll be 3rd and 3 at the Raider 40 when we return to the Astrodome. Right now, an update. Well, an interesting point that Dressel was one of Elway's receivers at Stanford. He has just caught his first pass of the day here in Houston. It's 3rd down and 3 at the Raider 40. That's Dressel in motion.
You saw him watching the receiver and sensing when the receiver was reaching for that ball, Hayes went up and touched that ball and knocked it away. That's the reason that Hayes has been in the Pro Bowl so many times.
It's a personal milestone for John James, his 1,000th career punt, that second all-time in the National Football League. Jarrell Wilson, former Kansas City kicker, the all-timer. And the ball will be out of bounds, marked at the 12, 13, 14, 15-yard line. So the Raiders will begin at their 15-yard line. 4 minutes and a second left in the first half. Raiders and the Oilers, and the Oakland Los Angeles Raiders lead the overall series 20-10. All three of their postseason meetings. But the very first game ever played in the American Football League, these two teams met, and it was the Oilers beating the Raiders 37-22. George Blanda was the quarterback for the Oilers. Tom Flores for the Raiders. And, of course, Houston went on to win the very first American Football League championship in that year 25 seasons ago. Here, no score. 4 minutes remaining in the half. The Raiders from the 15. Kenny King. And King fumbles.
statistics on fumbles from 1983, and indeed, when these Raiders were beaten during the season, it very often came as a result of their own miscues, interceptions and fumbles. And it looked like Kenny King was going to shift this Raider offense into high gear with a very fine run. But Bostic, number 25, coming from behind, stripped that ball away, and Brazil alertly picked it up.
The first turnover of the game at the 32-yard line. He's still on his feet. Earl Campbell out of bounds at the 10-yard line. ...22 yards for Campbell. All-time average yards per game. Jim Brown, the only man in history to average over 100 yards every time he played, but Campbell is second all-time and considerably ahead of Peyton, Dorsett, Simpson, and all the other great runners. And Campbell showing he still has outside speed. It is a first down at the 10-yard line as Houston threatens with less than 4 minutes left in the first half. A scoreless tie. Campbell. And nothing there. Raiders, in fact, pilfered the ball long, heading the other way, but after the whistle.
I think maybe Howie would love to have had that ball, but I don't think he wanted to run 80 yards to the other end zone. And there's Hugh Campbell. Dick, we talked about the short end zones in our NFL brand of football, and this is a chance to watch the Oilers work against that. And of course, if they can get Campbell running the ball, they pull that defense up to pay attention to him, and that gives Moon more room for the passing game.
Second and 10, or second and goal from the 10. Campbell goes out, and Hugh Campbell brings in a better pass receiver, Donnie Kraft, number 40. Third-year man from Louisville. The crowd on its feet as the Oilers threaten to get on the board.
And he just shot that ball in between those two defenders. That's a great play.
The extra point by Florian Kemp is good. The Houston Oilers, after a fumble recovery, and we've got another pushing match as the Raiders and Oilers have been dancing throughout this half. Sean Jones, 99, being pushed away, a rookie from Northeastern, by his teammates. The fumble recovery at the 32. Moon gets the score on a 10-yard rifle shot to Holston, who was shaken up in the end zone. The Oilers lead the Raiders 7-0 late in the first half. So Hugh Campbell has his first touchdown as a coach in the National Football League, and the man he brought with him from Edmonton, Warren Moon, fired it to Holston 10 yards, and the Oilers lead 7-0. Clee Montgomery and Doki Williams are deep for the Raiders. Here's Kemp's kick toward Montgomery at the 6. The 20. And a flag down as Montgomery is tackled at the 30-yard line after a 24-yard return, and we would guess that the Raiders will be pushed back with another infraction. And there's Warren Moon, a happy quarterback on the sidelines. Let's go back to Coach Hugh Campbell as he observed Moon's touchdown throw.
Campbell's first NFL touchdown for his team under his control. And look at that. You see almost a great sigh of relief from the man.
On the return, number 56 on the receiving team. Illegal block. First down.
Jeff Barnes, and that means the Raiders are back at their 12-yard line to start this series with 3:12 remaining in the half. Well, this is what Hugh Campbell was hoping his team could do. Stay close early. Use all that enthusiasm. Now this crowd is starting to believe. They came in late. They seemed almost disinterested, but now they're very much behind this young Oiler team. They lead 7-0 with 3 minutes and 12 seconds left in the half.
Watch number 26 on the left side of your screen, McElroy. Number 71 is Pickell. He's putting the pressure on Moon. Moon rolls to his left. Now you'll see the receiver, Mike Holston, coming in right here with McElroy right behind him. Watch the shot. That's Matt Millen. That's 270 pounds. You saw a picture a moment ago of Holston on the sideline, and he really took a shot, but he hung onto the ball, and that's the critical thing.
A remarkable throw by Moon, and perhaps even a better effort on the reception. Bucket from deep in his own end. To Marcus Allen. And he's down at the 15-yard line, a gain of only 3. Robert Brazil, who recovered the fumble that set up the Houston touchdown, made the tackle.
Talking to Jerry Glanville, a defensive coordinator for the Oilers, asked him about his team and who he was happy with and so forth. He said, you got a couple of youngsters down there, Bingham and Brazil. He said they're playing like puppies with all that enthusiasm.
Bingham in his 12th year and Brazil in his 10th. .243 left in the half. Going upstairs to Barnwell. Flag is down. They're going to call interference against Steve Brown. That'll be a 35-yard penalty.
I'm sure the Raiders saying it's about time we got one called in our favor. Certainly most of the breaks and most of the calls have gone against them here in the early going.
There was a bump before the ball arrived. And Brown called for interference at midfield.
Defense, number 20, first down.
Well, it couldn't have been 20. 24 was the only white jersey in the picture.
Well, they tell us on the other side, and it is the call here by this official who apparently saw it just before. He saw him reach for his hanky a little earlier. Of course, he can't throw it till the play is finished. There it is.
Well, Brown, you can see why Steve Brown was upset. That was really a close call. But the Raiders will take it at the 46 of Houston with 2:41 left in the half. Allen likes the throw. And he's going long. Doki Williams right in his hands. Oh, you can't throw a ball better than that. Marcus Allen, who threw for 3 touchdown passes last year.
What a pass. Now, Matt, we've seen Marcus throw the ball. Most running backs at this point are going to turn off and run with the ball. But Marcus rifles that ball about 55, 60 yards in the air, and Doki, who's a great sprinter, gets it in his hands in the end zone. I don't think he believed Marcus could throw that far.
Well, Allen was a high school quarterback in San Diego, and last year he threw 7 times, completed 4, and 3 of those were for touchdowns.
Certainly should have been 1-for-1 in a TD here.
It remains 7-0 Houston. Plunkett to Christensen at the 35-30. And Todd Christensen out of bounds at the 22-yard line. First down for the Raiders.
It's 24. A very important series for the Raiders. We look at the numbers that really established Todd Christensen as such a major factor in the successes of the Raider team last year. 92 yards. You see him pointing a finger back at Plunkett, who did indeed drop that right on target here. But Christensen apparently coming in excellent shape, right at his playing weight of 231, and quickly becoming a factor in this game.
Leading receiver in the NFL with those 92 catches last year. That was his second today. First down, Plunkett going for the tying score. Christensen. He was covered by Greg Bingham.
Talking to Raider coaches and to Al Davis early, they were concerned about whether this Raider team was ready to play. And I think, well, you get a feeling for them. They started slowly in this game. Intensity, emotion are two qualities that make such a difference in a ball game. The Raiders have not had it, but the events of the last few minutes may have stimulated them and got their hearts pumping and the adrenaline pumping a little bit. See, Flores, he's concerned. Al Davis was a man who was worried about them. He said, hey, I'm not sure we're ready to play. Well, they're seven down at this moment.
Christensen and Bingham on the coverage, incomplete. So Plunkett now is only hitting on one out of three throws, six completions in 18 attempts for 74 yards, while Moon, a little better numbers, 7 for 13, and he has the only touchdown of the game.
Plunkett throwing to Christensen, and one of the things you can't simulate working out for yourself, the timing of the quarterback and the relationship between the quarterback and the receiver. Christensen, you see, moaning a little bit there. Perhaps if he had spent his time in training camp, he might well have caught that one instead of missing it.
Yeah, the ball was certainly catchable, and timeout called by the Raiders with 2:16 remaining in this first half. The Oilers lead 7-0 on Warren Moon's 10-yard touchdown throw to Mike Holston. You see, the Jets have scored and have tied the game at Indianapolis at 7 just before the half. And the other late game, Denver leading Cincinnati 13-3. This telecast presented by authority of the National Football League is intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of the Houston Oilers and the National Football League is prohibited. The Super Bowl champion Los Angeles Raiders opening on the road here in Houston. And it's been a struggle the first half for Jim Plunkett and Tom Flores as they have been shut out with 2:16 left in the first half. And of course, at halftime, we'll bring you up to date on all the scores of week one in the NFL and some upsets.
Better check with Axe. I thought I heard a horse asking to renegotiate his contract the other day, Dick.
Yeah, a couple buckets of oats and he was satisfied.
He wanted a little more of that grass, hay instead of that other stuff they were feeding him. Bring me some of them good things.
Well, it is true that Gene Klein, the owner of the San Diego Chargers, when he sold his interest in the Chargers a month or so ago, said, well, the one thing now, I can still follow the Chargers, but my horses, and he has 200, 300 of them now, the thoroughbreds, he said, they don't have agents. Third and 10, a big call for Plunkett. Six defensive backs for the Oilers. Christensen almost intercepted. Christensen had to break it up as the coverage from Darryl Meadows from Toledo University.
Extra defensive backs in on the long yardage situation. Plunkett deciding to take the option to his tight end. Todd is driving outside, but Meadows, anticipating the move, just waited for him to get out there, and they're lucky it was not, in fact, an interception and a safety.
Well, that was good coverage by Meadows.
Touchback.
We saw him trail him. He was trailing Christensen all the way from the line of scrimmage after that initial contact. So Chris Barr will try a 40-yard field goal to get the Raiders on the board here in the half. And it is no good. Wide to the right. It remains 7-0 Houston.
Dick, there's something I remember from my playing days very well. Anytime you go into an indoor stadium, the crowd can become a factor very quickly. The noise level in this stadium is almost multiplied by two. And this is when this crowd is aroused, they're a loud and noisy group.
Let's run down quickly all the scores. Miami wins at Washington, an upset, and five touchdowns for Marino. San Diego, a big winner at Minnesota. 30-27, 49ers in the final seconds win at Detroit. 28-27, the Giants open with a win against the Eagles. Moon to Campbell. Campbell running over his own blocker and is down at the 25-yard line. And the whistle sounds. The two-minute warning has been given here at the Astrodome in Houston. As you look at Marcus Allen, he bloodied earlier in this game, and the Raiders have been shut out to this two-minute mark. Houston leads 7-0.
Super Bowl winning coach of the Los Angeles Raiders. A winner on the field, admired and respected. And off the field, he's a leader in his community.
Most of all, I want to congratulate all of you for your efforts, for your caring.
As a Spanish-American, he was raised among people with diverse backgrounds.
When you work as a volunteer, you don't get paid. Why do you do it? Why do people volunteer for certain things? Who can raise their hand and tell me?
Volunteers get love and respect.
These students in the La Raza course in creative writing are learning to express pride in the rich heritage of their Spanish origins.
In America, everybody has a chance. Everybody. Natalie, a very nice paper. Keep up the good work. Congratulations.
He knows their goal is to be the best their hearts and minds can make them. United Way salutes the work of La Raza and volunteers like Tom Flores.
Thank you very much. Gracias y adelante.
This message furnished by the National Football League.
The Astrodome, the Oilers leading 7-0 over the Raiders. 2 minutes left in the half. The other scores today. New England wins at Buffalo by 4. It was Atlanta upsetting New Orleans 36-28. Kansas City, there's another upset. Wins at Pittsburgh 37-20. The Bears at home against Tampa Bay, a big winner. St. Louis falls short at Green Bay. The Packers by 1. Jets and Indianapolis tied at 7. In Indiana and Denver leading Cincinnati 13-3 at the half. You're up to date. 7-0 here. Houston, 10-yard touchdown. Moon to Holston. Oilers ball, 2nd and 7 at the Houston 25. Moon on a draw. Moriarty, 4 yards short of the first down. Merlin, it was interesting yesterday that Hugh Campbell thought that his team this early in the season and with all the coaching changes offensively is even and maybe a little ahead of his schedule.
Well, one of the reasons for that, he selected Kay Dalton, who'd actually been here at Houston, who allowed the continuity of the terminology. The biggest change for a coach coming in very often is being able to speak the same language with your players. Well, Campbell was able to come to agreement. In fact, he said, Kay Dalton thinks like I do on offense. And he was thrilled then to keep the man here who had been in charge of the program, change some philosophy perhaps. But the thing they were able to keep in place was the terminology. And the reason for that makes it so easy is only Warren Moon and Hugh Campbell had to learn the new terminology. Everybody else could speak the language, and that probably saved him. Hugh said it saved us half a year in our transition.
So a little tougher on the head coach and his number one quarterback. But in terms of the total team effort, that was the obvious answer.
Well, and the obvious thing we're seeing here, they're not afraid to go for it on every play. I mean, it's a go-for-it kind of offense, just as they are on defense. They know they don't have the kind of personnel the Raiders do. There's no question that they cannot match that way. They have to match with big plays. So far, in this ballgame, they're doing it.
The Raiders hoping that they can stop the Oilers here on 3rd and 3 with 1 minute 53 seconds left and get the ball back for a final chance in this half. Moriarty, the lone running back. Moon. Sliding to a first down at the 34-yard line. He was known more for his running talent than his passing at Washington. It was a rollout run pass quarterback option for Don James at Washington, and he was not drafted by the National Football League.
Warren Moon has impressive speed. Two defensive players, one right there and a second right there, had a chance to make the tackle. Moon, well, that's the practice we told Jim Plunkett he better practice on, or the slide that we suggested Plunkett practice on. Excellently demonstrated by Moon there.
Clock running, 111, 110, and Howie Long, whether drawn offside or not, we'll soon learn.
They're shifting Howie Long and Alzado all over in that defensive line on the pass downs, trying to get a mismatch.
Encroachment, number 75, defense. First half.
Rather startling statistic, Merlin. The Raiders in their Super Bowl championship year last season, 16 games plus 3 playoffs, 19 games were never, never shut out in the first half. And they've got a zero up there with 110 remaining in this half.
And they don't have the football. They're going to have to get it back if they want to put points on the board in this half.
Moriarty out to the 42-yard line, a rather safe call, and the clock running at 104 now stopped by Houston. So the Oilers call the timeout.
I almost have the feeling that the Oilers maybe have gone a little bit conservative in the last few seconds of this half. Comfortable perhaps with that 7 points they have on the board. I don't think that's going to be enough to win this game.
Warren Moon following James Harris, Doug Williams, Vince Evans, the fourth black quarterback to start in the National Football League. 5-year contract he signed for a reported $5.5 million. And he's brought not only his passing skills to Houston, he's brought his famed chocolate chip cookies. He's going to open up some cookie parlors here in south of Texas. He was the Rose Bowl star for the Washington Huskies as he led them to an upset win over Ohio State. It was Michigan 27-20 back in 1978. He's from Los Angeles Hamilton High School, so he's not only playing against some people he knows rather intimately, but he knows they're watching back home in Los Angeles this afternoon. 7-0 the score. Campbell back as the lone running back. A short hop that one. Dressel, the intended receiver. Wonder if Moon's arm was hit. That ball flopped short.
I don't think so. I think he saw Otis McKinney, number 23, coming up quickly and wisely decided to pull that one down a little bit. Throwing in front of the receiver that way is certainly the way to keep the defenders from intercepting the ball. You remember Terry Bradshaw always did that so well. If he had a receiver running with a defender behind him, the ball was thrown low. If the defender was between him and the receiver, the ball was thrown high. That's the same kind of thing here.
Third down, a short three. 1 minute exactly left in the half. Campbell ran into his own blocker, and he got the first down anyway, out to the 45-yard line, right up the back of his right guard, Pat Howell, number 66.
That's a big, strong offensive line. They don't quite have their coordination yet. They're not quite all on the same page, and timing a little bit off on that play. In fact, it looked awkward, but ended up in a first down.
Well, that is a most interesting young line for the Oilers. They average, the five starters, 6'4½, 278 pounds, and they're less than 24 years of age. Man-to-man, Salem, number 2 draft pick out of California, his second year. Mike Munchak, number 1 pick in 82 out of Penn State at left guard. The center, Bruce Matthews, number 1 pick out of USC last year. Howell was a number 2 pick of Atlanta in 79, the right guard. And Steinkuhler, the number 1 pick this year from Nebraska. So this is the foundation for the Oilers of the future. This is where Campbell and the Houston organization has begun.
Tom Flores had an interesting comment. He said, and you see the youth of the rest of this team as well, he said, that's the way to build a team. But he said the coaches who made those drafts are not around.
Yeah, they don't get to enjoy the fruits.
That's right.
Because, as has been the case, the Oilers won only one game 2 years ago and only 2-14 last year. And have not won on the road for 3 years. Moon goes deep and too long for Steve Bryant. 44 seconds remaining.
Well, so much for being conservative. They come back shooting for the end zone. 44 seconds left in the half. Be 3rd and 10. Maybe a chance here for the Raiders to get their hands on the football before the half.
Oilers have one timeout remaining in the half. Ball at the 45. 7-0. The only score followed the only turnover of this first half. A fumble recovery by the Oilers at the LA 32. And a Moon touchdown throw of 10 yards to Mike Holston. Touchdown receiver Mike Holston. So he's okay back in the lineup, but a flag down against Houston.
I think the Munch might have been caught on that one. The Munch put the crunch on him in there. They're going to get him. Munchak, I believe, the guilty party. You know, they didn't think he'd be able to start. 4 weeks ago, he had arthroscopic surgery on his knee, and they said, you know, that we'll bring him back when he's ready to play. And they told him yesterday he was going to start in this ball game. And because of that injury, he's probably behind where he would otherwise
Holding
have been.
Offense number 74. Second down.
Sorry, Munch. It was your partner in there. Bruce Matthews ticketed with the call.
Matthews, who is part of a celebrated NFL football family. His dad, Clay Matthews, a linebacker with the 49ers in the 50s. His brother, Clay Jr., an outstanding linebacker with the Cleveland Browns. And now Bruce Matthews, who followed his older brother Clay at the University of Southern California, has moved now inside to play center for this Houston team. A draw. And it's good for 4 yards for Moriarty. Clock running 30 seconds, and who's going to call this timeout? The Oilers? No, the Raiders.
Yeah, they'd like to get their hands on the football at least once more before the half.
And apparently they will. That'll bring up fourth down, and the punting team comes on. Or no, it's third down now. It looked as if they're going to swing it to four, but the penalty, of course, that was part of this series. That's the last timeout for the Raiders. Houston has one remaining with 30 seconds. What do you think? The Oilers will stay on the ground, try to chew up some time?
Well, I think they'll... I don't know. It doesn't really matter what they do at this point. I don't think they're going to do anything risky. What we can look for is what happens if they have to punt the ball. Will the Raiders try and block the punt? I think the answer to that one is yes, they'll be coming, trying to get their hands on that football.
Well, next week, another NBC doubleheader. We hope you'll join us. Another outstanding slate of games. And following today's activity, two interconference games that bode well for the AFC strength as Miami wins at Washington and San Diego wins big at Minnesota. Denver, Chicago, New England will be at Miami. They both won today. Buffalo will try to rebound against the Cardinals, who also lost a tough one. And Kansas City will be at Cincinnati. Our major game late will be the Chargers at Seattle. Cleveland will visit the Los Angeles Rams. And the Colts will play here in Houston. All next weekend. Two games on NBC. Stay tuned. NFL 84. 30 seconds left. First half. Well, they know that the Raiders are out of timeout, so Moon just kneels, and Elzado gets in a final left jab on Moriarty, and the crowd doesn't like it.
I'm amazed that we don't have a flag on the ground. Several players not only shoving, but some fist swinging down there.
Sure, the officials feel, hey, that's going to be the end of the half, no matter how you cut it anyway. The Oilers don't have to punt, and why throw a flag?
Dick, we talked about a David and Goliath kind of game. So far, David's doing pretty well. Moon loaded up that slingshot, got himself 7 points.
Yes, he did. And the Raiders.